So welcome everybody at the ECE Colloquium, and it is my pleasure today to introduce Alberto Sainz Dalda. Alberto graduated in physics from the IEC in 1999, and then he took a pause before getting his PhD, and he decided to learn how to operate a telescope. He spent 9 years operating TEMIS, and I think learning a good deal of things from Arturo, some bad things, some good things.
Very good.
And then he decided, well, you know, I had enough of telescopes, so let's go back to study. And so he earned his PhD in 2009 under Valentin Martinez-Pillet, which is the currently NSO director, as you well know. And then he moved to the United States. He went to Stanford, Lockheed area, working on Hinode, and then an HMI when this was flown. And after 5 years there, now it's our pleasure to have him here at the show as a project scientist. And today you will speak of the beauty of asymmetry in Stokes V profiles.
Thank you. Thank you for your introduction. It's my pleasure to be here and to be part of this prestigious institution. So I guess the idea of this colloquium is to explain it to you where I had been doing in the past and what I'm going to be in the future in this institution. I would like to start apologize to the some people. Some people here knows a lot of polarimetry, many of them math that more than I do. But maybe others have forget some concepts that we learned when we were in the school. So I'm going to do a brief introduction about polarimetry that I think is necessary to understand what I'm trying to talk about today. Okay, so we know that the electromagnetic waves are transverse waves. Because they are transverse, they can be polarized. That means that the oscillation can be changed in direction through the propagation of the electromagnetic field or magnetic field. When we talk about polarization of light, we are mainly talking about electric field polarization. As you know, we can decompose the electromagnetic field wave in two perpendicular planes. And if they are oscillating with the same phase and with same amplitude or different, you have linear polarization. When these two components are oscillating with a phase of 90 degrees, but with the same amplitude, you have circular polarization. And when they are oscillating with different amplitude and different phase than zero, then you have elliptical polarization. That means that the observer will see an ellipse, a circle, or a line. Okay? So in the general case, we have to describe an ellipse. This is what is called polarization ellipse. To describe this ellipse, we use four parameters. They are called Stokes parameters. They are other ways, but this is what we are using in solar physics. There are another way, and you have to be careful because sometimes we say, why are you not using the Jones vector? The Jones vector is for total polarized light. The Jones vector is also related with the amplitude of the signal, and we cannot measure amplitude. We can measure intensities in our CCD. So that's one of the reasons why it's so convenient to use the Stokes parameters, because they are relating the amplitude squared to the square. This is the intensity. That's what we measure in our CCD. Okay, so with these four parameters, we can describe perfectly this ellipse with the major axis, the small axis, and the inclination of the ellipse. That in a special case is going to be a circle when the axes are equal, or a line. Okay, so as I told you, what we are measuring in our CCD are intensities. So what we do is to take different intensity images with measuring different states of polarization. We can combine these intensity images and then recover the Stokes parameters. And then we can characterize the polarization ellipse. Yes?
H just a sign? Is that just a positive?
Yeah, H is a how is this ellipse is rotating. That's correct. And as you can see, H is given by the sign of V.
Oh, I see.
Okay. Okay. So the main idea what I want to show you here is that what we are measuring in our CCD are intensities, and just taking different measure with different polarization states, we can recover the Stokes parameters, and then we can characterize this ellipse, what is the way that the electromagnetic field is moving in the propagation. Okay? Okay. The question is how the light can be polarized. So there are the main thing that we have to keep in mind is that the polarization is produced when the interaction between the radiation field and the matter is affected by any mechanism who is breaking the symmetry. That can be done with all these physical elements that we call the electric anisotropy elements, that they have an orientation in their molecules or in the atoms. And then we use all these properties of the elements to polarize, to select different polarization. Okay? How this is what we are using in the lab, in our sunglasses, these things, right? What is happening in the sun is the interaction, the pure interaction with the radiation field that is in the solar atmosphere with the matter, the atoms, the molecules, mainly. So there are several ways of polarization. This is the scattering polarization. And there is the impact polarization and anisotropic polarization. Two kinds of anisotropy case of when the radiation field has a determined orientation, right? Or a beam of particles, okay? There is the presence of an external agent like the magnetic field. When the magnetic field is enough strong, we have the Zeeman effect. And there is another possibility that we have a scatter polarized light, and then we have also a magnetic field. In this case, a weak magnetic field is enough, and then we have the Hall effect, where it's mainly a decrease of the linear polarization of the scatter polarized light, and a rotation of this plane. Okay, I'm going to talk a little bit about the Zeeman effect because this is what I'm going to use on the data I'm going to show. They are affected by this process. So as you know, the Zeeman effect is the split of the atomic or molecular levels by the presence of a magnetic field, right? So we have the total angular momentum, what is characterizing the level, the energy level of our atom or molecule. And then when there is a magnetic field, what is happening is it will be here, for example, this is the ground base, the ground state, and this is the first level. So there will be a split in 2 × 1. When the transition is between the level, the upper level 1 and 0, we talk about the normal Zeeman effect. So that means in the ground we have 0 levels, and in the upper level there is a split with 3 levels. We have a level where it's keeping the same energy, that means the same spectral line, the same spectral position, and there are going to be 2 lines shifted plus and minus with the what is called the Larmor frequency, right? The split of this line is proportional to the magnetic field strength and to the square of the spectral line. So that means that, for example, in the infrared, it's going to be larger than in the visible lines, right? If we are looking the magnetic field alone, the direction, if we are looking the atmosphere alone, the direction, the same direction of the magnetic field, what we are observing is the circular polarization, okay? So we will be observing simultaneously these 2 circular polarizations. And if you make the decomposition of this intensity in a spectra with a slick spectrograph, for example, what you have is this shape. This is the characteristical shape of a Stokes B profiles, what is giving us information about the circular polarization. If you are looking at the perpendicular direction, what you are observing is the linear polarization. And in this case, you have these 3 possibilities, these 3 spectral positions, and then you have this characteristic profile. Okay. In general, we are going to be observing the magnetic field in any direction, so we will have generally both polarimetry, right? States Stokes B, Stokes Q, and Stokes U, what is perpendicular, what is 45 degrees with respect to this, and intensity. Okay, so when we go to observe, that's what we have. This is the Stokes images. Just as a reminder, what we have is four images similar to this one, to this intensity, and then we combine them and recover this IQ1B. And then if you make a cut, this is the spectral distribution of these Stokes profiles. Okay, this is intensity, Q, U, and B. As you can see, in this profile, apparently, I, Q, and U, they are symmetric with respect to the lambda zero, to the nominal position, the rest position of the spectral line, right? They are symmetrical to this position and to this position. However, Stokes B is antisymmetric. They are symmetric with respect to the zero cross point, where it is here, right? Okay. So, now we have to understand a little bit how these profiles are generated. That means how the Stokes profile within this notation is I in this notation is IQ1B, changes through the atmosphere. Through the atmosphere means through the optical, through the continuum optical depth, which is given by this formula, okay? So we have an absorption, an emission, and we have the source function here, right? This equation is called this is the radic transfer equation in the vectorial notation. This is the propagation matrix. We have eta and sigma terms. The eta is giving us the probability that the atom or molecule absorb a photon during the process of in the atmosphere, okay? And this is given by this equation, what is given by the Boyd function, okay? The eta terms, okay, you can distinguish there, they are giving us information of magneto-optic effects, okay? So, here, what is the source function is only affecting to intensity, usually. This is one of the considerations that we are using. Okay? In local thermodynamic equilibrium, this term is the Planck function. And it's only affecting to the intensity. Remind us this is IQ, U, and B. Okay? Okay. So this is the general frame for the radic transfer equation. To solve this, to get IQ, U, and B, taking into account all the information that is here include, as you can see, we are including the inclination, the magnetic field strength. Here we have the V loss, okay? So we are including the properties, the thermodynamic properties and magnetic properties of the magnetic field. That is very complex to solve. So we make assumption to simplify this problem. The first one, and very common and popular, is the Milne-Dittner approximation. That means that all parameters that define the atmosphere are constant through the optical depth. That means that there is no variation on magnetic field, the damping parameter, the line to continuum ratio, the Doppler, sieve, the velocity. There is no variation. They are all constant. Okay? That means that this matrix is going to be constant. The other assumption we do is that the source function is going to be a linear with respect to the optical depth. Okay? With these equations, we can recover very easily analytically IQ, U, and B. Just in function of these terms, okay? So, the Stokes parameters, I'm going to, for any spectral position, they are going to define but this all these parameters. That's because we are making the assumption that there is no variation in the parameters through the atmosphere and because the source function is linear with the optical depth. Okay. Other assumption, a little bit more realistic, let's say, is the local thermodynamics approximation. In this case, we can calculate the electric pressure with the temperature and the element's abundances. This is given by the hydrostatic equilibrium. And the local thermodynamic equilibrium allows us to calculate the level population just determined by the given by the temperature through the Saha and Boltzmann equation, as you know. In this case, the atmosphere can have variation through the parameters that they are defining the atmosphere can have variation through the optical depth. There are numerical methods to solve this, and this is a little bit more complicated to explain in this case, but what I want that you keep in mind is that the two easier assumption that we do is the Milner-Hinton approximation and the local thermodynamical equilibrium. This is valid this is fitting very well in the photosphere, but not definitely in the chromosphere, when we have to take into account the coupling between the level population and the radiation. In this case, it's not given only by T, by the temperature, but also by the radiation. So then we cannot make this assumption, and to solve this problem is a little bit more complicated. What I'm going to show you is just only in the photosphere. Okay. So very early, somebody, Egidio Landi and Landolfi, they realized that in a static atmosphere, that means no velocity, macroscopic velocity at all, then these parameters are perfectly symmetric and antisymmetric, the Stokes B. That means that if you make the integral over lambda of Stokes B, as is antisymmetric, should be perfectly zero. Okay? This is what is called net circular polarization. Further, some people investigate how is the relationship between the net circular polarization and the gradient. And this is very important. As you can see, this is the variation of the velocity line of sight. This is line of sight velocity. And this is the strength of magnetic field. So that means that if any of this is zero, that means that it's constant, then you have net circular polarization equals to zero. That means that in the Milner-Hinton approximation, where all the parameters are constant through the atmosphere, all the Stokes parameters are going to be symmetric, and for the Stokes B, antisymmetric, because they are constant. There is no gradient of velocity and magnetic field. And in the LTE approximation, there will be zero when the line of sight is constant through magnetic field. That's easy to understand, right? Well, it's not so easy. Okay, let's show this example. Here you can see this is the line of sight velocity, and this is the magnetic field strength. This is the optical depth. In this unit, the photosphere is in this yellow region. This line, this is iron 6301 and 6302, they are the lines that Hino is observing. So is where these lines are sensitive. So as you can see, there is no variation. Below is constant. And in this case, I have a constant value of magnetic field. And if you pay attention to these profiles, Stokes B, the only thing that happens here, is that the Stokes B profile is shifting because we have a line of sight velocity. Stokes I is shifting, the Stokes B is shifting, but the shape is perfectly symmetric. These numbers are the net circular polarization calculated between these two lines and between these two lines. These lines are moving because the center of the line is moving. So I always calculating the net circular polarization in this spectral range. Okay? So as you can see, that's correct. So except some numerical artifact, net circular polarization, zero. Symmetric profile, no gradient in V, no gradient in V loss. That's correct. OK, and now look at what is happening. We have now we have a gradient. We have a variation of the magnetic field strength, okay? And we have a B loss constant. And you can see here is absolutely symmetric. So the important thing is that the variation of the velocity in line of sight is constant. Even if you have a gradient of V different than zero, these profiles are going to be symmetric. Yes?
Just had a question about the basis. Are these done with a Taylor expansion or something?
Yes, the expression of the gradients?
Yeah.
It's a kind of zero-order approximation. It's given by this paper by Jorge Sanchez Almeida. This is a numerical solution, yes. This is a synthesis. Sorry, I didn't mention. This is a synthesis of these spectral lines in an LTE code. So I have the ability, the possibility, to introduce gradients, and these lines are computed taking into account the radiative transfer equation under the LTE, local thermodynamic equilibrium condition. Okay. So now let's see what's happened. Now I have a variation, a gradient in velos. And look at these profiles are going to be anti-symmetric. It's going to broken the symmetry, especially when it's becoming larger, right? Remind that the information is coming from this region. And now, as the gradient is very strong, you can see that there is an asymmetry at the net circular polarization is different than zero. OK? And now we have both. In this case, you can see the asymmetry is really strong because you are combining both things. And then the net circular polarization is very different than zero. Now it's constant, so it becomes zero. And now it's changing again. So what I mean is that you have to be careful with the expression that is relating the gradient of velos and strong magnetic field, strength magnetic field. What is determining the net circular polarization and the asymmetry is the gradient of velocity. But you can have gradient of magnetic field also. So for example, we can have this crazy behave, like a Heaviside function, when you have a steep gradient here, and you can see the line is becoming almost a single lobe. The red, this is called the blue lobe of the Stokes-B profile, and this is called the red lobe. And as you can see, it's almost disappearing. Well, this is a little bit crazy, right? Maybe not. So the interesting thing is that in the early 80s, somebody made the calculation and said, OK, the net circular polarization should be zero. But StemFlow in a Fakula region found that there were many places where the net circular polarization was different than zero. I'm going to show you a map with Hinode with the net circular polarization for the lines that I showed you before. And as you can see, this is the intensity. And this is the net circular polarization. So I have integrated around 6301. For every single pixel, the spectra. And as you can see, there are a lot of signal, of course, around the pores where the signal is strong, but also here and here. So definitely, that means that there are many places where the net circular polarization is different than zero. So that means that there are many places where there is a gradient of velocity, at least. As I showed you this image before, and I showed you, they are very symmetric. But there are places, as you can see here, where you have signal very far in this side and not here. Or here, where is a lot of signal in the black side and not here. This is an asymmetric profile in Stokes-B. In these places, the net circular polarization is definitely different than zero.
So could this also be caused by a breakdown in the Millington approximation?
Well, in the Millington approximation, you can only reproduce symmetric profiles, and that's what this is important.
Yeah, that's what I was asking. If the Milne-Eddington is not valid, can it lead to similar effects?
No, I think what you're trying to say, or maybe let me tell it to you, maybe, is that with the Milne-Eddington, you cannot reproduce these profiles. You cannot reproduce. This is observations. That means if you are using a Milne-Edington approximation to recover information from the atmosphere, this is what we call inversion code, in all these pixels, it's not going to work properly because they cannot fit symmetric and asymmetric profiles by definition.
Okay, so the velocity gradients are a departure from Milne-Edington itself, you're saying? But what I'm saying is you see the asymmetries and you're inferring them as a velocity gradient or a magnetic field gradient. But could they also be that your matrix is not constant?
In fact, there is. There is an option. There is the option. There is a magnetic quantum mechanic behave of the matrix, of the absorption matrix. There's a paper by Arturo López Ariste explaining this behave. But usually, in most of the cases, and in the photosphere is the main reason, is because you have a gradient of velocity and maybe a gradient of magnetic field. Okay? Okay, so now people start to think, oh, we have a lot of places where we don't have net circular precession equals to zero. So then we have to measure the symmetry. There are several ways to measure the symmetry. Some people measure just the intensity of the lobe. I mean, where is this peak? Other people measure the area of this lobe and compare with the area. Okay, so that's mainly the net circular precession is telling that the area of this and the area and this should be equal, but not the intensity, and that can happen, right? So some people, as you can see, detect all these profiles in this kind of in events in and they, how they are related with different phenomena in the solar atmosphere, but always with a gradient in velocity, line of sight, okay? So then we investigate a extreme case. It's when we have just only one lobe. The other lobe has disappeared, or they are close to the noise level. This is what is called single lobe Stokes-Debye profiles. So what is happening is that we have a really a strong gradient in velocity. And there are several events that reproduce this case. One of these is the canopies. One of these is that you have a small loop and there is no magnetic field below, but there is up. So there are several options. So we investigate this, and you can see here, this is the observation. This is called red only because you have only the red lobe, and you have the blue only profiles because you have only the blue part. Okay, so we investigate that, and we use a numerical simulation developed by the Norwegian people. Juan Martinez Sicora was working with me on these things, and we synthesize the atmosphere given by the numerical simulation with the LT conditions, and we reproduce these single lobe profiles, in this case blue only, and in this case red. And as you can see, there are pretty similar to the ones that we observed that I saw you before. Is here? Okay, is here, okay? So they are pretty similar. Of course, we just introduced the PSF of the instrument that we are trying to simulate, but we didn't introduce noise. And this is the levels of the noise. This is two times the noise level, and this is three times or something like that. Okay. So then we develop a code to find where these profiles are, okay? And the blue patches represent where the blue-only single lobe Stokes-Debye profiles are, and the red where the red-only single lobe single Stokes-Debye profiles are. As you can see, they are in patches. They are not just isolated. And the blue patches, apparently, they are located in the outer part of the granules, while the red, they are in the intergranules. We did a statistical study with 74 different maps with different exposure time in different locations in the sun from HINO data. Okay, And then we do a statistical analysis, and this is the main conclusion for the statistical. I just only showing you a map. Okay, in this case, in the granulation. The blue only are more related with the outflows, while the red only are related with the downflows, also because they are located in the intergranules and the outer part of the granules, of course. And this is another interesting thing. They are located around the network patches. So they are located mainly in the low or mid-strength magnetic field, right? They are not on the strongest area. They are around these areas, okay? But they have inclination. They are mainly inclined because they have also in linear and circular polarization. And then we compare with the simulation. We have this amazing numerical simulation. And as you can see, the behavior is mainly the same. Now the patches are narrow, but they are showing the same behavior. The red, they are in the intergranule, and the blue, they are in the outer part of the granule. Maybe you don't believe me. That's why we use histograms, right? And this is the observation. This is the intensity. The red line describes the behavior for the red only single low stress B profile, and the blue for the blue only. And as you can see, it's very similar for the intensity, okay? And this is for the line of sight. This is for the mean circular polarization, sorry. So the behavior is relatively similar. It's surprisingly similar, in fact, because one thing that is important is how is the distribution through the solar disk and the ratio between the blue only and the red only. And this, as you can see, this is the center. As I'm going far to the limb, this ratio is decreasing. The color is giving us information about the temporal, the dispersure time. So it's not depending on the dispersure time because we have points all around. Surprisingly, the numerical simulation, what is the diamonds, are reproducing exactly the same. Yes, Phil. Yes, this is the mean circular. So this is circular polarization. It's, if you want a Stokes B map.
So I just wanted to make sure that I understood that what you're seeing there is that the image is the bulk of the magnetic field, and then these other red and blue are the red and blue components that you found.
No.
You're seeing sort of the bulk of the magnetic field is not red and blue, and it's off to the side, like you said. I just wanted to make sure that I understood that you're not just looking at the red and blue component, ones with the red and blue asymmetry.
No, 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 no.
You're also looking at the ones which have equal, no.
No, no, no,
equal
no.
Lobes.
No.
And that's the bulk of the
data. Yeah, this is, yes, exactly. Yeah, so they're correct. Okay. Okay, so then we try to do inversions. We try to recover from the observation what is the atmosphere in the sun. As we know that that may happen when you have this kind of behavior, okay, that means that in the, as I told you before, the atmosphere is going up in this direction. So this is, let's say, the chromosphere. This is the bottom of the photosphere, and this is the upper part of the photosphere. So that means in this case, what is this? This is velos, sorry. So that means that you have, well, let's say in magnetic field strength, because I don't want to deal with the sign now. That means that in the bottom part of the atmosphere, you have a strong magnetic field, and in the upper part, the magnetic field is smaller. And they are very well defined where this is broken. It's a step, okay? And the same behave in the line of sight velocity. And with this atmosphere, you can reproduce these profiles. The blue dots are the inversions. That means that I'm fitting a synthetic profile. I'm trying to fit a synthetic profile, make an iteration until the fit is good enough to match the observer profile. And this is the atmosphere that I'm recovering. But we have numerical simulations. Okay. Look at what is happening in the numerical simulation. I have the same behave. I have single lobe, blue single lobe stochastic Weber files. I don't have the red lobe, and I have the same. I have a step function in the magnetic field strength. Here is not so a step, honestly. Okay, and we have also a gradient in inclination. And we know that this is the atmosphere is reproducing this, because this is the numerical simulation. Okay, so this is what is happening in this case. This is what we call flash emergence, because as you can see, we have these pink lines, where is the stronger line, and it's going up. This is not really strong, as you can see. It's 300 Gauss. It's not very strong. It's a small loop in the quiet sand, but it's going up. I have in upper of this, in this cube, I have just a small magnetic field. And we do the statistic, and we found all this behavior for this case. Red case, similarly, I do the inversion, I feed, and I recover this atmosphere. And I can reproduce exactly the same. I can find exactly the same behavior in the numerical simulations. In this case, the topology is a little bit more complex. But again, it's something like, in this case, there is some cancellation, and this is submerging because the line of sight velocity is going down. So as you can see, just because these profiles, they are perfectly defined in the terms that they have one lobe, we can make assumption about how the atmosphere is behaving. And we can try to understand what is happening in these places. And these places are coherent, especially. The point is that for doing that, I was using a very handy method based on the shape and based on the levels of the lobes of the Stokes-Weber profiles. A few years later, I learned something about how to classify these profiles. So this is the other part of my talk. In March last year, we were observing an amazing flare happening in this active region in March 29th in Sac Peak. We were so lucky that when we were observing, we asked, we have a joint observing campaign with Hinode and with IRIS, and we sent to IRIS the day before the command to please observe here. Just pure luck. But we were there. So then we observed simultaneously this flare with Sac Peak, with IBIS, where was observing 6302 calcium infrared. This is a chromospheric line, H-alpha. Calcium infrared and iron line was observed with polarimetry. So we have IQ, U, and B. For H-alpha, we don't have all the Stokes parameters. And simultaneously, we were observing Helium 10830, what is a spectral range, what is containing a silicon line, what is photospheric. So in the same spectral range, you have photospheric information and chromospheric information. And this is a slit spectrograph instrument. So we have a bunch of data, all this data, in fact. We have data from Hinode a little bit before the flare, unfortunately. Data from IRIS, data from, of course, AIA, SDO, and all the instrument in NSO, in DST, right? So we have a huge volume of data. And again, I was interested to understand what is happening in these places where there are gradients. And I know that these places are characterized by the shape of the Stokes-Weber profiles. So then I use a clustering method that is used as machine learning method by all these companies. They are very smart because they use this simple technique to make money. We try to make papers with this. Okay. Exactly. So let me explain it to you how this method works. Let's say we have this bunch of points. Okay. So what I'm going to say, and I have to say, sorry, how many clusters I want. I have to say I want to divide this set of data in two clusters or in five. This is the only thing that you have to say. Okay, how many clusters do you want? Let's say you say two. The method works like that. I'm going to select randomly 2 points. This is the random point selected by the code, and this point. In the data set, I select randomly 2 points. Now, I'm going to calculate the Euclidean distance of any point to this point, or of any point of the data set to this point. And I'm going to sort in terms of distance. So the closer data, the closer points to these points, they are going to say these points, and the closer to this are going to be this one. And then, in this small set, I'm going to calculate the mean value. This is why it's called k-mean. Okay? And in this data set, I'm going to calculate the mean value. And I'm going to iterate until the distance between all the points is constant to this k-mean. The k-mean is going to change. Let me show you. So for example, here, I have run the code for 3 clusters. And as you can see, this white dot is the initial random point. And it's changing this point in time because it's classifying in different clusters. But at the end, mainly, it's going to be this, this, and this. So it's very, very easy way to cluster a huge volume of data. Just only the only problem it has is that you have to say, I need 3 clusters. And you don't know how many clusters you know a priori. But there are techniques to determine what is the optimal value of the clusters that can reproduce a data set. It's working most of the times. There are other more sophisticated methods for clustering, but they are computationally more expensive. And this is very easy to implement. This is 10 lines of code, including comments. And it's really, really fast.
Can you empirically determine the optimal number of clusters, like testing on the rate of convergence, how fast?
It's something like that. You calculate the cost function, and you iterate for 100 cases. And then the function is going to do an elbow. It's going to be a decrease. And where the elbow is the optimal value of clusters. But sometimes it's not so evident. So then you have to do visually. And this is what I did with this data. I investigated this data. I used to investigate that. You can see here is the ribbon of the flare, one of the ribbon. The other one, it was here. And the first thing I'm going to show you is the analysis that I did for Hinode. Unfortunately, Hinode, the slit of Hinode was observing here when the flare happens. And the flare happened in this location. So it's a little bit late, but we can at least know how was the region where the flare happened 20 minutes before. OK, so I'm going to show you a different approach with all these Stokes B profile clusters. In this case, there are 10 clusters. There are 3 numbers. This is just the number of the cluster. It's just a label. And here is how many pixels in our data belongs to this cluster. So this profile is the k-mean profile. This profile is representative of one of the clusters. As I said, 10 clusters, there are 10 k-mean profiles. And finally, this is the percentage of the pixels belonging to this cluster. So I analyze this data, and we conclude that we need at least 30 classes. OK, so this is the 30 classes. As you can see, there are a lot of that they look quite symmetric, okay? But definitely there are others that they are a little bit more challenging, or this. And this is the number of profiles, the percentage of this class. So the interesting thing is that this is done in 3 minutes, and you can locate where these profiles are. So where you see these white areas is where these pixels are located. So mainly in the umbra, but also in this part. As you can see, it has a little bit of symmetry in this red lobe. Another interesting case, this one. Well, this is clear that there is an asymmetry, right? There is a shift and a symmetry. And they are coherently located in this area. This is the place where the ribbon is happening, exactly there. Yep.
Let me just summarize and make sure I understand. The clustering you're using is basically automatically developing classes of line profiles that you can identify.
That's it. It's an what is called unsupervised machine learning code. The only thing that you are telling is, I need 3, 30, 10. And automatically, it's going to split. In this case, what I did is, I don't care about the intensity of the profiles, how large they are. So I normalize every single profile, and I pay attention to the shape, because I showed you at the very beginning of the talk that the shape is giving me information about the gradient of velocity and magnetic field. So I know that in these places, there are going to be gradient of velocity and magnetic field, probably. So in these places that where flare is happening, I cannot trust inversions based in no variation of the magnetic field or velocity. They are, well, I can trust, but they are failing because they cannot reproduce. Yes. That was before.
Yeah.
That was before.
Has something like that been identified with other techniques before?
All these things has been done. This classification has been done by Jorge Sanchez Almeida and by Bartolomeo Bitice in 2010, probably. But they only classify the profiles. They don't look at where they are or trying to explain. What I'm doing is just using this technique in a massive data set and say, okay, in these places is where we have to pay attention. So the clustering methods are quite old. This method, I think is in one of the slides, is from 1959. Oh, yeah.
So I was just wondering if that's been explored.
No, not until
really
as far as I know, I don't.
But if you produce maps like that, you can see structures in actual regions that look like this.
Yeah.
And the flare didn't go off that.
Yeah.
It's just another way of looking at possibility of prediction.
Yeah. This is definitely a tool.
Yeah.
It's a tool to identify places where are interesting. This is mainly the
it hasn't been used at all in applications.
In this way, I don't, as far as I know, no. So look at our single low Stokes B profiles, and they are in patches. They are coherently located in the solar, and they are shown here in the one of the foot points of the flare ribbon, and other here, and also in the outer part of the penumbra. As I told you, we have also 10A30. We have also other data from other instruments. So why not apply this? And I do exactly the same. In this case, also 30 classes. In this case, you have two lines. You have two lines. You have the silicon line. This is intensity, silicon line. And this is Helium 10A30, where it's a triplet. So when you have a Stokes B profile, you have this line where is corresponding to the silicon line, and you have these two or three peaks in Helium 10A30. Remind that this line is photospheric, this is chromospheric, high in the chromosphere, in fact. So this is, as you can see, this is a normal Stokes B profile. If you make the derivative of this line, what is a good approximation for in first order to the Stokes B profile, you can see the peak and the valley. And you can see the peak and the valley, the peak and the valley, the peak and the valley in the 10A30. OK, and now we have this interesting case. You have silicon line in absorption and 10A13 in emission. That makes a little bit challenging the understanding. But as you can see here, we have peak valley. Is this peak valley? No, sorry. Valley peak. And we have valley peak, valley peak, valley peak. The same polarity, but it should be opposite, because this is emission. So that means that where these pixels, where is this white line, and the, in this orientation, the ribbon is exactly here, in this pixel, we have a polarity, reverse a polarity in the photosphere and the reverse in the chromosphere. Just only looking at the profiles and the cluster and the k-mean profile. So this is what we did with FIRST, and we conclude some results just only looking at this map, right? They are very basic as result, but they are very straightforward and very fast. And then if you go to a inversion now, you have to take into account that you are trying to reproduce this. So definitely it's a good diagnostics tool. We have also IBIS.
Just a quick question.
Yep.
Do you have the QNU search profiles for that?
You can do for anything. And you can do...
No, but I mean, how horizontal was the field in that phase where you get a reversal in height?
I don't know. I have to check it. But this is challenging because you are necessarily Q and U doesn't have to match. I mean, you can see how is the Q and U of these profiles that they have the same feature in B, but it can be different, very different. They don't have to have a nominally at the same behave. It's like intensity. You cannot say, oh, I can look at now intensity. Well, yes, but. No,
well, you have polarity reversal between the
geometry of the field a little bit better.
Yeah.
But in this case, okay, so then.
Well, it's pretty much equivocal, right?
No, absolutely, yeah.
But in this case.
It's very horizontal, it could just be a yeah.
So. Yeah, so then in this case, what you have to do is a vector where it's IQ, U, and B.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And make the k-mean classification on the old vector. And then you cluster all the vector, I, Q, and B. You can do that. And this is another option. Lucha used the same technique in Lucha Klein, using the intensity profiles from IBIS from Calcium. And in this case, as you can see, I don't know if you can distinguish, but there is clear absorption profiles, and we have some emission profiles here, right? This is intensity. This is not the Stokes B. But we are using the same technique, the k-mean classification. And then, as you can see, if she wants to make a doppelgram, so just fit in a Gaussian to the intensity profile and calculate the shift, something very simple, or the bisector method. Definitely, it's going to work here. But in these profiles, it's going to fail. So probably in these profiles, you need another method. And that's what Lucha does. Lucha classifies the intensity profiles, and some profiles use the Gaussian method. In other profiles, use the bisector method. And in other k-mean profiles, use two or three Gaussian. And at the end, we have a very coherent doppelgram. This is the combination of several of these k-mean, of these velocities calculated from different k-means using different methods. So that's the end. In this case, just to pay attention that the k-mean is just a numerical method. We have to interpret what is the classification doing and when, what the k-mean means. So thank you.
Okay. Questions? Yep.
Question. What about, you've never talked about them, but horizontal gradients, because this precursor to the flare of an area, could those asymmetries be due to
strong
horizontal gradients too?
In the first part of the talk where I talk about the single law of Stokes B profiles, many of these single law of Stokes B profiles, they are related with strong gradients also in the inclination. So definitely a gradient in the horizontal. So I have not done this analysis for the flare.
I mean, I'm just talking about pixel resolution. Is it true that horizontal gradients, due to the lack of spatial resolution, only affect the amplitude asymmetry but not the area asymmetry? Is that correct?
Well, you know, the area asymmetry is really, you know,
I mean, these gradients are effective along the line of sight, along the optical depth that is forming the line itself, right?
The ones that you
show. So if you're mixing...
But you could basically have several different...
Yeah, I mean, if you can, then the overall effect is smearing, right?
Yeah.
But so you'll end up with asymmetries, too.
Yeah,
if
probably.
You have different velocities in different parts of your pixel and different...
But the main zeroth order effect of smearing is a reduction of amplitude, typically, I guess.
But also symmetry.
Is there definitely something special about the fact that this observation is a flare?
This
observation is a flare or a pre-flare. Is that definitely what's causing these things? I mean, do you have other observations of non-flaring regions where you never ever see these V?
No. They are very, very, very common. Absolutely common. I showed you the strain case, but it's the single lobe, and that is in the quiet sun. I mean, in the, yes. They are very, very common. This is why the map I saw at the beginning with the pores, this map, I mean, in this image, any single place where you can see signal that means white or black is a little bit saturated, but is not definitely very saturated. You can see all this signal here. That means that there is a gradient. That means that you have an asymmetry in a Stokes B profile. Definitely in velocity, maybe also in magnetic field.
But do you have some kind of threshold? Because there is also a signal to noise thing. If you
This is what I'm telling you. I really, really didn't saturate this map. I mean, they are definitely above the signal. I cannot tell you twice or three times, but they are definitely all these points. Well, definitely this, right? But all these points, they are definitely above the signal. Thank you.
There's this magnetic carpet thing, which is somewhere in the chromosphere, the magnetic field closes, which means that, I mean, in many, many places, I'm just leading towards that there are probably numerous, many magnetic null points somewhere there. Now, my question is, so suppose a magnetic null is in a pixel which you happen to observe, how it's going to affect, I mean, suppose an X,
well, an X point usually is very high. I mean, it's not definitely in the photosphere. Well, because usually it's a loop, what is going farther in the to the chromosphere or even farther.
Well, I mean, they're important when they're studied in the loops, but I mean, technically, the finer scale magnetic features, I mean.
But anyway, let's think that is happening a reconnection in the photosphere. That's happened very often, right? So the point is that it's a little bit complex in this case because when you are mixing polarities, it's very easy to have asymmetries, okay? But not necessarily. So in this case, you are just in the limit of the, I mean, in the resolution. You can have in the same pixel box both polarities just because they are mixing polarities. And then you have a cancellation. But even in this case, you need a different velocity. Other way, I'm thinking in one of these three lobes, Stokes B profiles, that you have a peak, a valley, a peak, and then ending. And this is the composition of one normal Stokes B profile and the other shifted. And that's can happen. It's that they are very usual in the polarization inversion line. And this is something similar to a cancellation. I mean.
Phil?
Do you have a feeling about the wavelength resolution that you need and the number of points? So for instance, if I observe this thing with HMI or MDI, would I see anything like this?
I did with HMI, and HMI 6 points. And this is why I think in the ASTRAT, I wrote almost any spectral data. And this almost, it was because HMI. Because if you don't have enough points, that the cluster, I mean, is not, it's going to fail extremely easily. I did, and it didn't work.
Chroma has kind of a dozen of wavelength points across. Yeah, I mean, I'm surprised at what you're saying, because I remember that you know, in the early days of the preparation of the HMI science case, you know, people like Arturo were doing principal component analysis and machine learning, you know, vector machine to determine what the optimal number. Minimal optimal number of wavelength points to do these inversions were. And I remember that these 6 points came out exactly from this principal component analysis, which is another way of doing clustering, right?
You see asymmetries.
Yeah, I mean, definitely, if you have a single low V, right? I mean, you cannot miss it.
But mostly in numbers, you don't really see it in the quiet sun, because the spatial resolution is not good enough either.
And there is also another fact, right? I mean, with 617.3, you only have one line. Right.
Yeah.
And of course, the clustering is going to be a smaller number. I mean, here with the 6301, 6302, you have all the ratio between the lines that pretty much, you know, square the number of clustering that you need.
Yeah.
So I have a question, practical one. So clustering seems like a way that you can, you know, classify shape. Has anyone tried to use these to speed up inversions by, you know, creating sectors of parameter space
I'm trying to do, and this is the thing I was doing in Lockheed before coming here, is that, okay, now I know that I have a bunch of points that they are clearly showing gradients.
Yep.
And there are going to be a large number that they are not showing gradients. So then you can feed the inversion, like, okay, these points, as you know, when you are including gradients, the iterations are longer and you need more nodes. And so it's computationally more expensive than when you don't have gradients. This is because we are using, for example, Milne-Eddington code for Hinode, one of the reasons, right? And then you can say, OK, to these clusters, you use this method. To this, the other. Because Or different, I mean, different configuration, different atmosphere. That's the interesting thing of this method, is that you are classifying. That's good. You are locating where they are in the solar surface, and then you can use as a proxy to make argument about the inversion. I have done an analysis with IRIS spectra. With PCA, because you can do that with PCA. You can decompose all, and then you can do the k-mean on the PCA components. Instead of working with 112 points in Hinode, you can work with 20, and it's more than enough.
It's slightly different because PCA gives you.
It's different. It's different. But what I'm telling is that if you have a huge database, you can reduce. PCA is reducing the dimensionality.
Yeah.
And then, on this reduced dimensionality, you can use k-mean. The thing I do with IRIS is that IRIS profiles magnesium K and H is changing so much that if you want to feed the interesting profiles, instead of, you have an interesting profile that instead of have two peaks and the valley in K, you have a real weird profile with intensity, all intensity. If you do PCA, you lose these profiles. Or, I mean, you need a large number of coefficients.
Really?
You need 100.
No. I mean we tried with Scott applying PCA.
I have here the
Iris. These actually were, I wonder if they were, no, maybe these were Bifrost simulations, actually.
No, I have.
And we know that the Bifrost simulation don't reproduce Iris data very well.
Well, I cannot. This is the conclusion of the power of IRIS that I didn't show. The conclusion of the power of IRIS is all the, and that's normal, all the diagnostic analysis they do, they are based in numerical simulation in quicksand.
Yeah.
Okay? That's what you can reproduce.
Yeah.
If you go to a flare, and we have flares, I mean, it's absolute. You don't have ratio between this peak, but because there are no peaks, there is only one peak, huge. So it's failing. You cannot use this method.
Well, I mean, again, Scott applied PCA to these simulations, and he was able
Simulation, if they are
with 10 profiles.
If this simulation they are quite sound, they are going to be very similar.
Yeah.
The profiles are very similar. Yeah. The point is that when you have a flare, you have a very few profiles that they are very different. So then you go to have a large number of coefficients. I can show you later. It's done.
Any other questions? Well, then let's thank our speaker again.
Thank you.